Alright, hello anatomy friends, this is Dr. Alsip, and in this video we are going to focus on the infrahyoid muscles, aka the strap muscles, which are named because of their strap-like or ribbon-like appearance. So with the infrahyoid muscles, there are two different layers. There will be a superficial layer and a deep layer, and we'll talk about which muscles are in which layer. We'll also talk about what these muscles do, what are their actions, and lastly, what innervates these muscles, with three out of the four sharing a common innervation and one outlier, and we love a good outlier. All right, so let's get our bearings regarding where we are in the neck and where these muscles are located. Kind of the key relationship and where this group gets its name is that all of these muscles are inferior to the hyoid, thus the infrahyoid. So let's get a clue of where we're at. So here is your hyoid bone. Let's take a moment to discuss the hyoid bone because it's a really important landmark in the anterior neck, and particularly a lot of what we're talking about today. It is going to be located around the C3 to C5 vertebral levels, and that's going to be between the mandible and the thyroid cartilage. So I always describe, if you palpate your own anterior neck right in the middle, you will first feel your thyroid cartilage because it's the part that projects the most anteriorly. And more to come on the thyroid cartilage later, I promise. But if you move your fingers a little more superiorly, and sometimes I have to kind of tilt my chin down, you can palpate the hyoid bone. Certainly more difficult to palpate than the thyroid cartilage, but it's possible to palpate it. This bone is unique in its isolation from the rest of the skeleton and the fact that it does not directly articulate with any other bone. Rather, it's completely suspended by muscles, tendons, and some ligaments. So, the hyoid's functioning as an attachment site for many anterior neck muscles, including the infrahyoid muscles that we're talking about right now, and it can also play an important role in propping the airway open. Alright, so that's our quick stop to talk about the hyoid bone, and all of these muscles will be inferior to it. The infrahyoid muscles will also be superior to the sternum, which would be right about here-ish, so not projecting into the thorax region. The muscles will also be medial to the carotid sheath and its contents. So here would be a carotid sheath here, a carotid sheath would also be located over here. And lastly and importantly, these muscles will all be superficial to the thyroid gland and the larynx. So one has to reflect these muscles to gain access or view these deeper structures. Now, as mentioned at the beginning, there are two layers or planes of muscles. The superficial layer is going to be composed of the sternohyoid, as well as the omohyoid, which is a personal favorite of these infrahyoids because it's so unique, with the deep layer made up of the sternothyroid and the thyrohyoid. And there's that hyoid bone right there. If you have a thyro or thyroid in the name, you know you're talking about the deep layer. So let's talk about each one. We will start with one of the larger ones, and this is the sternohyoid, which you can see outlined here in blue. I have bolded the attachment points that match up to the muscles' names, and you will see that it's a common theme for these infrahyoid muscles and many other muscles in the body. This muscle will extend inferiorly from the sternum and medial clavicle all the way up to the hyoid. So here's your hyoid here, your sternum is right here, and your clavicle is right here. It, as you can see here, completely blocks the view of the deep strap muscles, so this has to be reflected in order to see any of those. This muscle, like most strap muscles, will play an important role in stabilization of the hyoid, so kind of keeping it in place while other things happen. Also, just looking at the location of this muscle, if you think about this muscle concentrically contracting, so shortening, it makes sense that it will take the hyoid with it inferiorly, thus depressing the hyoid. Okay, this next muscle is a fun one, the omohyoid muscle. This muscle is unique amongst the infrahyoid muscles because it has two bellies. It has a superior belly and an inferior belly. These bellies are going to be connected by an intermediate tendon, which is tethered to the clavicle by this fascial sling, which you can see here outlined in this lighter blue. Does anyone know what the prefix OMO, what does OMO mean? Because that gives you an indication of where it attaches. It means shoulder. So the name Omohyoid indicates that that inferior belly will have an attachment to the scapula, or the shoulder, but more specifically the scapula, with the superior belly attaching to the hyoid bone. Similar to its superficial partner, the sternohyoid, the omohyoid will play a role in stabilization and depression of the hyoid bone. All right, moving on to the deeper infrahyoid muscles, let's start with the sternothyroid. Note that the sternohyoid had to be removed in this image in order to see these muscles. This muscle will extend inferiorly from the sternal manubrium. You can see it even is heading a little bit towards the clavicle as well. So there's manubrium here. All the way up to the oblique line of the thyroid cartilage. Note something important here. This muscle does not make its way all the way up to the hyoid bone, so it does not attach to the hyoid. So not playing any direct role in hyoid bone movement. Based on its location and attachments, when it contracts, it can play a role in depressing the larynx if it was previously elevated. So you can see, if this is your thyroid cartilage right here, think about if that contracts, it will pull the larynx down. All right, moving on to the last of the infrahyoid muscles, and also the smallest, is the thyrohyoid, which extends inferiorly from the oblique line of the thyroid cartilage up to the hyoid bone. So there's a hyoid bone again. I'm going to keep labeling it because it is such an important area here. So when it concentrically contracts, it can depress the hyoid bone, but also based on its other attachment to the thyroid cartilage, it can elevate or bring up the larynx as well. So kind of an opposite of what we had with the sternothyroid. And so it's all about the location of these muscles. Thyrohyoid is the muscle that is the oddball in terms of innervation. An anatomist love a unique innervation. I would always suggest putting stars or hearts or whatever works for you next to any time that you have something unique in terms of innervation or something unique in terms of actions. This is something that almost always finds its way into some form of assessment. It is innervated by fibers from the C1 spinal nerve that are not associated with Ansa cervicalis, which is going to be the innervation for the other three infrahyoid muscles. These fibers of C1 will travel with, or what we often refer to as hitchhike with, the hypoglossal nerve. And we'll talk a bit more about what we mean by hitchhiking in a moment. All right, the rest of the infrahyoid muscles are innervated by the beautifully named Ansa cervicalis, one of my all-time favorite anatomical names, which is a branch of the cervical plexus, similar to those afferent nerves from the nerve point of the neck or Erb's point. Fibers of C1 will hitchhike, similar to what happened with the thyrohyoid. So fibers of C1 will hitchhike along the hypoglossal nerve or cranial nerve 12. So some of those fibers will shoot off to go innervate thyrohyoid. And other C1 fibers will leave that close proximity to the hypoglossal nerve to join the superior limb, or to form, excuse me, the superior limb of Ansa cervicalis. Sometimes you'll have fibers of C2 also forming the superior limb. The inferior limb of Ansa cervicalis is formed by fibers of C2 and C3. So the Ansa cervicalis will send small muscular branches to all of the infrahyoid muscles, excepting the thyrohyoid. So let's return to this concept of nerve fibers hitchhiking with other nerves, because this is something that will come up quite commonly throughout our discussion of nerves in this course, particularly when we get to the parasympathetics. So keep in mind that nerves are just collections of axons wrapped up together by connective tissue in the peripheral nervous system, so your PNS. Axons may travel with or in close proximity with different nerves, particularly if this is a smaller collection of axons on their way to the target tissue. So you can see here in this nice cartoonish rendition that I made, the fibers of C1 that are destined for, say, the thyrohyoid or to become the superior limb of the ansa cervicalis are going to travel in close proximity to the hypoglossal. All right? So they're very close to one another. They're traveling together, but they still came from different sources. So the hypoglossal nerve, it originated in the medulla oblongata, and of course C1 is from spinal cord level C1. So they are coming from different sources, but they can travel together for a while and then eventually move towards their different targets. So the C1 fibers hang around the hypoglossal nerve before pivoting off in different directions. So you can see traveling together for a while, and then it's heading off, say, to either the thyrohyoid or to become the superior limb of ansa cervicalis. So that's what we mean by hitchhiking. Like I said, this is something that we will talk about over and over again throughout the course. So if this is an area that's confusing, return to this, think it through, and if any remaining questions, always feel free to reach out to us. All right, so we've had so much fun with this area. I have two questions instead of my usual one. So hopefully this one isn't too tough. Which infrahyoid muscle has an attachment to the scapula? Only one of the four will have an attachment to the scapula. Is it A, omohyoid, B, sternohyoid, C, sternothyroid, or D, thyrohyoid? So take a moment, and hopefully you have landed on the correct answer, which is A, omohyoid, and this omo is that key here. Omo indicates shoulder, so the scapula is part of the shoulder joint, so that is going to be one of the attachment sites. Recall in your reviewing that the infrahyoid muscles are named for their attachments, and this can really help a lot in not only remembering the attachments, but really thinking through what the actions of these muscles are. All right, one more question. All right, injury to ansa cervicalis would not affect the actions of which muscle? Is it A, omohyoid, B, sternohyoid, C, sternothyroid, or D, thyrohyoid? Pause the video if you need a moment to think through. And when you're ready to move on, let's discuss that D is the correct answer. This nerve is innervated by separate C1 fibers not associated with ansa cervicalis, so D, thyrohyoid, is the correct answer. The rest of these infrahyoid muscles are going to be innervated by the ansa cervicalis. Well, that was a lot of fun. I do love talking about muscles. As always, as you review and have any questions, please do feel free to ask. Thank you for your time and attention.